A continuación, Lotte Bransen nos platicará sobre cómo la analítica de datos nos puede brindar información clave para definir la estrategia y toma de decisiones en un partido.
Well, thanks for the kind introduction, Santiago. So I'm Lotte. I will present stuff about women's soccer and machine learning. And I will first introduce myself a bit more. So I'm from Utrecht, the Netherlands, very far away. I'm based there, born there, and I've done my master's degree in econometrics, a combination of mathematics, data, and economics. And then I started as a data scientist at Sizepots 6 years ago. Sizepots is a Dutch company working for football clubs, using data to help clubs to recruit new players, but also to do some tactical analysis, opponent analysis, and also to help players to find a new club. So career advice from a perspective of a player. Then 2 years ago, I started my PhD in KU Leuven. It's in Belgium. And there I've been working on like continuing my work that I did already at Sizepots on using machine learning techniques, especially for women's football. Because, well, I'm also happy to see some women in the audience. Because I think it's good that there's more attention for this. Thank you. So I will guide you through this presentation through three main topics. Some questions that scouts might face, maybe not really rephrased like this, but this is like behind the questions that they ask. So they are like curious in how will the player adapt to a higher playing level? How will this player impact the results of this team with his actions or his or her actions? And then how will players impact each other's performances? And then, how can we use data to answer these questions or to help people, scouts, to answer these questions? So to start with this, we first need to know what kind of data is there. It has already been touched upon quite a bit today, but I think it's good to quickly rephrase it again. So there's actually three main types of data. Of course, there's like differences between those types. We have match sheet data. That's like data on match sheets. So like the lineups, the score, players playing, the playing minutes, and the goals and the cards that have been given in the match. The good thing about this data is like widely available. We can find it for highest amateur level for women in the Netherlands, maybe even for like some amateur levels in other countries. We can have this data for men and women on a very broad level. But well, the downside is that it's not really that granular. So we don't know a lot about what the player did in this match, but we do know that she played, how much she played, and if she scored a goal or not. Then the next step is like the boy-friend data. That's more descriptive. It describes every action that happens on the match. So you get like the event type, what kind of action, was the pass, the dribble, when did it occur, where did it go from, so where did it start, where did it end. And for some providers, you get even extra information on like the players that were like surrounding this action. And then the most granular data is tracking data. So it's typically captured by cameras in a stadium, and they capture the players and the ball, typically 25 hertz per second, so you get like 25 frames per second of all the players and the ball. The good thing is that it's really, really granular. You get everything that you actually want to know. You can compute everything from it, but like mostly everything. The bad thing is that it's really not really captured a lot, especially in the women's game. So currently it's captured in the Women's Champions League. They track the matches there from after the group stages, actually. So it's just a few matches. Women's World Cup, they do this, but it's really like something that's really new in the women's game, and also in the men's game, it's not everywhere it's captured. So what I will focus on mostly today is the event data, and what we can do with this, because we can do a lot with this event data, and we can find players, can scout them using this data. So the first part is about pace of play. So if you want to know as a scout, how will this player adapt to my level, and this level is higher than this player is currently playing at, it's difficult to know this, to like transform this information from the other league to a new league. And this is something that we've been working on recently to try to capture this in using the pace of play. So there's more aspects, of course. There's a lot of things going on when you go to another league. But what we've found is that pace of play, so the time you need as a player to control the ball and to do a new action, it's like an indicator of talent and also something, an indicator of like playing more at the team you're going towards. Players that show a high pace at a certain league, a certain team, they are more likely to play more matches in a higher level if they have like a higher pace than players that don't have this high pace, even if they played at a lower level and show this pace already over there. So this is something that can be an indicator when you want to scout players, and we can use these event data to compute this metric, which is rather simple. It's just computing the time of receiving the ball and then the time of new action. And then, well, we can analyze this in different parts of the pitch. And oh, as we're here in Mexico City, I thought it would be nice to show some Mexican players. For this, I looked at the Under-20 Women's World Cup. And there were actually two players that they were actually really standing out here. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. Mauleo and, Cortez, let's say it like that. And both of them, they showed like a high pace. So when they received the ball, they show a higher pace. And the blue areas are the ones, the positions where they showed this higher pace. And Mauleo is like an attacking midfielder. She also played on the right wing in this tournament quite often. Cortez is like a right back. So she's playing on the right side. And this already shows that when looking at players, you always need to take into context. It was already mentioned. We cannot really compare right back to an attacking midfielder because, like, higher up the pitch, you have less time to control the ball and to do your action. But compared to other attacking midfielders in this tournament, Marlene was like the second one. There was like a player from the American team. I don't remember her name, but she was a bit faster, but she was second there. So I think that's really interesting. Maybe a tenant for the future. I think she's selected for the Mexican team right now. But interesting player. And then to talk a bit more about the women's game. So I've been investigating the differences or like the improvements in the game. So more money is being put into it, which also has the result of a higher pace of play. So lower in this graph is better. So you need less time to control the ball. And this is data from the first levels in the USA, England, France, Germany, and Spain. So which are thought of like as the best leagues currently in the world. I think it's a good thing to see that it is increasing. And what's not in this graph, but it's also interesting, is that the accuracy of the passes is increasing. So they're playing at a higher pace, but still their passes are like better, actually. Like they find their teammates quicker. And I think that's a really interesting thing to see over time, that's increasing. So more money put in there is actually leading to better, higher level of play, which will be, I'm sure it will be keep increasing in the coming years to, and maybe also here in Mexico. So that's about the pace of play. The next thing is about how can we value a player's actions. Was already mentioned a bit, but I will go into detail like how we do this. And why do we do this? I have an example to show why we want to measure the value of an action more than just looking at assists and key passes. So it's something I worked on when I started at SciSpot, so it's about 6 years ago. And back then, what coaches, like scouts from clubs asked me, it was in a men's game, but what they asked was like, how many key passes or assists does this player have? Or like, what is the pass accuracy of this player? So how many or like how what percentage of passes reach their teammates? Which is interesting, but there's more to it. Because we can see in this video, so this is a long pass by Jansen, who plays to a teammate, and then actually, the teammate does something good, but then the other one who gets the ball here, she loses the ball. Play it again. So this pass it's about, this is a rather good pass, I hope you agree with me. But it doesn't turn, it's not an assist, not a key pass, not anything, it's not even a shot on goal. Next one. So this is a pass by Busquets. He has the ball over there. Okay, then Messi receives the ball. And yeah, we all know Messi. Unfortunately, you also know him now in the Netherlands, but he's a good player. He scored his goal. But Busquets got an assist over here, right? It's an assist, a key pass, an accurate pass, everything. But he's really rewarded for this pass by actually just passing the ball to Messi. And I think Busquets is a good player, don't understand me wrong, but it was not a great pass, not like a perfect pass. And the one by Jansen is not an assist and not a goal. Okay, so what can we do? We can value or we can measure the expected value of this pass. So what we actually want to do is we want to assign a value to this pass by Jansen towards the teammate Pep. And what we can do there is we can find a value for this action by looking at the pre-game state value and the post-action game state value. So what I mean by pre-action game state is like the action just before she passes the ball, what is the value of play when she has the ball over there? And then the post-action game state is like at the end of the pass, her teammate receiving the ball, what is the value over there? And what we can do is we can value these game states. So we are valuing every game state, and we use the data for that, and we can value two things, like how likely is it that it will lead to how likely is it that this game state will lead to a goal in the near future, and also how likely is it that you will concede a goal in the near future. Now, what we do there is we use this event data that we have to describe this event data in like a more like a computer language to get it into a model. So we have the events that happened up until this pass. So we know all these passes and dribble and then the pass. And then we look at everything that happened before the pass by Janssen was given, and also including the pass by her. Then we can describe this game state in numbers. That's something the computer will understand. And for this, we describe everything around this pass, or like everything that happened up until this pass, in the coordinates of the start and end locations of these actions that happened before this pass, the type of events, so passes, dribbles, crosses, the body part used, like for instance, a head pass is maybe more difficult to give. And also we include extra information on, for example, the speed of play, so how quickly are you moving up the pitch, which is also an indicator of how much space there is for you to finish your actions. Then we have like a lot of numbers, and we assign what we call in machine learning a label. So a label tells us, was there a goal within 10 actions, yes or no? And the thing with machine learning is that if you do this for a lot of different game states, so for the paper that we used here, it was like millions of game states, so thousands of matches, we can tell the computer, okay, this one was a goal, this one was not. And what it will do, this model, machine learning model, it will learn what is like a valuable game set and what is not. And if we do this for a lot of actions, or if we do this for a lot of actions from the women's game, we can learn what is a valuable game set in the women's game, and how can we then use this to value actions. Well, we use this model for a new game set that we haven't seen before. So maybe yesterday there was a match being played, we computed it, and we used the model that we trained to give a prediction for this game state, 0.03 in this case, and then we can use this to value actions. So if we go back to this pass by Janssen, we compute this for both post and pre-action game states. And then we use the model, we have two models, one for scoring a goal, one for conceding a goal. And if we do this for before the action and after the action, we see differences. So we see here that, what you might guess already, like, the chance of scoring a goal before her pass were lower than after the pass. And actually, she increased the chances by quite a lot. So this means that in total, she gets like what we call a VAPE value, VAPE rating of 0.044. So actually, she increased the chance of scoring by 4%, or like percent point. And that's something we can do for every action. And then we can compare it, the Busquets pass, I mean, and then we see that, well, the Busquets pass was like valued 7 times less than the one from Janssen. So actually, the Busquets pass didn't really increase the value of scoring. Well, in the end, Messi scored, but we tried to ignore this. So we tried to use the machine learning models to really capture the added value of this pass and ignoring the fact that Messi scored. Because he's a good player, but we want to scout players like, for example, get the gift passes like Janssen does. If we do this quite often, we can find talents. And we can find hidden talents, because everyone knows this Messi and Busquets are good. People in the women's game, they also know Jans is good, but there's also a lot of other players that we maybe don't know, and we can use data scouting to find those players and to find them before other people find them. Then something short on gender-based models. So this is something I've been working on in my PhD as well. It's maybe a bit like too many numbers on the slide. But I wanted to say here is that we checked whether you need to have like a gender-based model so that you have like a separate model for men and for women's data. And the conclusion was yes, you need that. So it's good to have like separate models for them, also taking into account the differences in the game. And it's not only about gender-based. I think in general, it can also be league based. So I think also the style of playing English Premier League is different than in the Dutch Eredivisie. A lot of people use similar models, but it's something good to take into account when you use your, when you train models, that the data that you're training on is similar to the data that you use it on. And that's why we at SciSports, we use, I think there's other companies doing it as well, but at SciSports, we also use like separate models for men and women. And then every time data comes in, we use the one that's for the correct gender. And then we can see that, for instance, this sequence, leader, with including the pass from Dominic Janssen, that there's different values applied to it by the men and the women's vape model. But I think the interesting thing here is the last one, the cross. And we see over there that like the in the men's vape model, this one is rated higher. As we see that, and typically men score those kind of chances quicker than women do in these situations. And that's why there's differences there. So we can use this to compute value every action. And if we value every action, we can do this for players, for every match that they play, for going in the past, we can compute it for every action. And we can also look at different types of actions. So of course, interested to see how much value you add as in a total. But what's really interesting, that's something that we noticed later on when we had the model, it's really important for scouts to know, okay, what type of actions is this player really performing well on. So again, I found three interesting players from the Mexican team, or like Mexican nationality. Nayeli Diaz, he's playing in the NCAA, so the college soccer in the US. She really stands out there. She's scoring high vape ratings on dribbles and take-ons, so really passing by a player. And also in crossing. And then Malia, we already saw her. She shows in the Liga MX Femenil, she shows like high ratings on passing and dribbling. And then Diana Ordonez, who's playing in the MWSL, so the highest league in America. And she's also showing high rate ratings, which is showing that she's really a good finisher, but also positioning. So receiving the ball in good areas. We can use these rate ratings like the machine learning models to really identify talents everywhere around the world where there's data available, so the event data is available. And this is, I think, really interesting to scout those players and those hidden talents or like those young players who might be available in the future. But then, that's cool, so we can, measure qualities of a player. But when you're really scouting for a team, whether it's like a club team or like a national team, it's not only about having the best players, but it's about having the best team. And this is something I personally like, because we won the Euros in 2017, the women's team of Netherlands. And actually, we didn't have the best players. Like England had better players, France had better players, Germany had better players. But we had the best team. We had the best coach, I think, but we also had really the best team. So they worked together. And like everyone, they knew each other really well for a long time, all those players. And they played the best together, and then they won the tournament. And that's something behind the next topic. So how do players impact each other's performances? Something we've been working on is what we call chemistry. So players, they need to play together well, right? So we can have a very tall striker who's really good at headers, but if no one crosses the ball to her, she's not going to score. Like if she only gets the ball like deep and she's not that fast, she won't score and she won't show her full potential, like the qualities that she has. And that's actually why chemistry is so important in scouting, for federations, for clubs, to find a player. And also for a player, if you move to another club, you need to play somewhere where you have like the players around you, which will make you stand out, which make you play better, and that you can also let other players play better. And that's what we try to capture, like what we call offensive chemistry and defensive chemistry. I will focus today on the offensive chemistry due to time. But what we looked at is like, okay, how do players improve each other's performances on like offensive and defensive parts of playing? And as an example, I use two players from the English team, White and Hemp. For those who don't know them, Hemp is a left winger. She's fast, good crosser. And White is a center forward, is like a target man or target woman, or how you would call it. And she's like good at finishing those crosses. and they play together for the English team. And what we can do then is we want to measure like what is their joint impact on English chance of scoring a goal. And what we do for this is we use the stuff around the vape rating that you just showed to measure the values of interactions. So it's going to be a bit technical, but if you have any questions, just stop me. To start with, I have a video again. So it's about the pass that's been given here by Leah Walty from Arsenal. And she's passing here to that meet. Who passes to Miedema and she fails to score, unfortunately. But what we want to look at is the interaction between Walty and Mead. So the one playing on the midfield and the one and the right winger. And then we have like an interaction between them. So we have a pass from Walty to Mead, and then Mead crosses the ball to Miedema. That's what we call an interaction. So this is something that those two players combined added to the game. So they combined, they caused a big opportunity for their teammate. And then we can use actually the models that that I showed before, like the ones to measure game state values. And if we do this for each of those moments, we see that, when we have the ball in the midfield, the chance of scoring a goal is 0.5%. And then passing it to Neat already increases this. And then in the end, there's a pretty high value of scoring a goal. So together, those two players added a value of 0.2 to this game state. So the game state was low, and in the end, it's just pretty high. And what we then can do is we can do this for a lot of different interactions. So we look for every moment in which Walty passes the ball to Mead and Mead passes the ball to Walty. And then we can sum other interactions and we normalize for the minutes played together because it's unfair to compare players that didn't play enough minutes together. And then we can compute offensive chemistry. So if we then do this, for a lot of observed player pairs, we find players that really gel well together. So they play at the same team and they show high chemistry. So these are some well-known players from Europe, and they gel well together. They make each other play better, which is a really interesting thing and something to take into account. But then the interesting thing is, how can we use this when scouting new players? Because, Hemp and White, they play for City both, or they played for City. So we know how they play together. But what if City is looking for a new player? Then, for instance, it's difficult to measure this. So, for instance, if you're looking at the English national team, then Toon is a midfielder and White, they never play together, just a few minutes. So we cannot tell anything about their chemistry. But maybe we can try to learn something about it and try to predict their chemistry, which we haven't observed. So what we do, collected a lot of chemistry pairs, so a lot of players play together, 57,000 pairs, and we computed their chemistry, so the interaction, some of the interaction values, and then we can try to predict, try to find patterns in the data to find which player pairs work well together and which ones do not. And then we present all those player pairs in using feature construction. So we construct feature vectors for every player pair. So for instance, here we have Hemp and White. We have something about where they come from, the position they're playing at, and also their age. And then we add more information. And this is more about the type of play that they show. So we know that for wingers, things around late crosses. So late crosses is the one that you really pass the opponent and then near the end of the line, you cross the ball forward. Passes to the box, cut inside dribbles, half space receptions. These are important stuff for wingers. And for strikers, we have different ones. So headers, long distance shots, short passes, and also box receptions. And then we can describe every player in such a way that we describe them with these values. Then these values are put into another model to make it to reduce the space, kind of. And then we have values for them, what kind of player they are. So we see that Byron Hemp, she's really a classical winger. So she's really one to give the traditional late cross. And Ellen White is, what I said, more like a target man and also a target man, poacher, and striker. Actually, she shows all three of those aspects, but mostly being a poacher, so finishing in the box. Then we add additional information that really describes interaction between those two players, like the whether they were born in the same country, whether they also or they also added to the model actually, which wasn't really something that told us a lot. It was like, do they speak the same language? Are they from the same area of the world? And when I started this this model, I was really thinking that would be like a huge factor, and it could be partly due to the data capturing. So, for instance, if you look at the Dutch competition, like the bigger teams like Ajax, PSV, Feyenoord, they are like able to get players from other parts of the world. So they typically show higher chemistry values because they work well together. And the lower teams, they have typically a lot of Dutch players. So then there's kind of some bias in the data. Like the teams with more different nationalities in there are actually the teams that are like performing the best. So that's something that's difficult there, but we try to capture it. And in the end, it actually turned out that like the playing style features were like most important in predicting chemistry between players. So we add the observed chemistry, and then we do this for a lot of player pairs. We actually used men and women's data, also youth data for this, like a lot of different data points. And then we put this into a machine learning model again, like a regression, because we try to predict like a value. And then we can compute for every unseen pair of players, we can compute what would be their chemistry. So if you, for instance, at the start of a tournament, so the Euros last year, and the coach of the English team was wondering, okay, which player should I play? Then she could have used this model to find like the best players, because the English team have so many good players, especially the attacking players, but which ones work best? And then we see that there's like there are two center forwards, White and Russell, and actually they are really different type of players and also work with different type of other players. And Russell is more like someone who really needs like the balls from the midfielders, and that's also why she works really well with Van Kirby, who's a midfielder. And then, for example, with White, we already seen that she would work really well with Lauren Hemp, and also with Chloe Kelly, who's also like a left winger with a traditional cross. So actually, this is something that you could use to either select the lineup, because what Coach Wiegman did at the Euros is that she always put down Toon and Russell together around the 60th minutes, and then she took off White and a midfielder. And then, in the end, it worked out pretty well because they won the Euros. But I think it could be interesting to find a lineup, but also for scouting. So finding new players for a team, I think it's really interesting to find players that gel well together, and I think something that's quite often overlooked by clubs. So they are working at clubs in Europe, in the Netherlands. They always want to find the best players, which is good, but you also need players that work well with the players you already have in your team, and not just add a good player to it and hope it works out well. So to conclude, I showed how we can use pace of play of a player to see whether this player would adapt to a certain level. Then we can use the game set values to value every action that happens on the pitch for every match, every player in a complete season. And then we can use a chemistry network, a framework, to measure and also predict chemistry between players. And ideally, that's something we haven't done yet, but future work. This is about player pairs. It would be really, really cool to do this for more than two players. So ideally, of course, 11 players and even more if you're like looking at your complete squad and squad building. That's for the future. And I want to also mention the people with whom I've been working with, because it's not all my work, of course. So this is something I've done together with Jesse quite often, and also Tom and Jan deserve the credits for this work. Then one thing I also wanted to mention is that for those who really want to get into football data, football analytics, we have a GitHub. It's mentioned over there, the K11 Soccer Action. There we have like open source the Fave framework, so you can train your own Fave model. It's also connected to some open source data sets, so you can use that. There's some tutorials there, so I hope it all works out, but if it doesn't, you can always contact me. That's about that. That's it. Thank you.